Welcome back to another episode of This Week on Channel 9. I'm your host, Christina Warren, Senior Cloud Advocate. And I know, I have been gone for a few weeks. I have seen your comments, but rest assured, the show is not canceled. I was just in some other countries, and then I was like taking some much needed time off because I've been traveling like crazy. Anyway, my shirt today is actually from my podcast, which is called Rocket, and it's about general tech news if you want to check it out, but it has our motto on it, which is make it weird. So make it weird. But anyway, enough of all of that. Let's get into this week's latest dev news. Okay, so first I kind of want to give a shout out to some of the different events that are happening right now. And the big one that's happening right now is the Insider Dev Tour, and it is taking place at cities across the globe. And so every year after Microsoft Build, the MVP communities, the Dev Collective, the Windows Office and Developers Tools teams, and the Insider team come together and they go on a global tour to show off the latest Microsoft 365 tech. And so this year, it's actually really cool because the tour has even more dev content than ever, with sessions on things like C# and .NET Core and JavaScript and progressive web apps and more. And so details on the cities on the Insider Tour that they're coming to, they are in the links and the description down below. Now, next up, in some industry news that I'm going to be honest, I really didn't expect to see, Microsoft and Oracle have announced that, and I'm just going to quote this from the press release, a cloud interoperability partnership enabling customers to migrate and run mission-critical enterprise workloads across Microsoft Azure and Oracle Cloud. Okay, so the TLDR is that this will let enterprises that use both Oracle Cloud and Azure use those scenarios together. And so you could maybe have like one part of your workload running in Azure, so maybe that's your AI stuff, and then you could have the Oracle database running on Oracle's cloud. But the really cool thing here is that when you connect these two clouds together, you can have a unified single sign-on. And in fact, Oracle applications, this is now in preview, will be able to use Azure Active Directory as their identity provider. So this is really cool stuff, especially for anybody who is in the hybrid development or operations space. And I've got a link to more details in the show notes and description. Next up, we've got a slew of GitHub updates. So first, GitHub Desktop 2.0 is now available. And so the biggest new features that are available in GitHub Desktop 2.0 are the ability to do rebasing as well as stashing within the app. And so stashing is a really great feature for those times when you might be working on some code, you're making a change, but you're not done yet, and you need to switch to something else. Now, you don't want to commit that code. You just want to kind of stash it, and then when you're ready to finish it up, you can either bring the changes to a new branch, or you can keep them in your existing branch. And rebasing is a way to basically start clean when you're merging various branches together, but you don't have that long commit history that sometimes, for some people, can kind of clog things up. So you can download or update GitHub Desktop to version 2.0 now, and I've got links to the blog post and downloads in the show notes down below. Now, in some other news, you can now generate a new GitHub repository using what are called repository templates. And look, I love this. This is a great idea. So basically what you do is you mark a repository as a template, and then you can create new repos with all the template repositories, files, and folders. And like, I can see this being so useful for things like tutorials or for maybe like internal bootstrapping apps that often use the same resources, for frameworks and more. I really, really love it. And the final bit of GitHub news is that the new GitHub package registry will be adding support for Swift packages to its mix. And so this is going to work alongside the Swift package manager, which is also available in GitHub, and it's a great way to distribute and manage your Swift packages. Next up, Visual Studio Code, my favorite app, got its latest update for May 2019. This is version 1.35. And this release brings some updated icons. I'm a big fan, but let me know your thoughts on the new icons in the comments. And the latest release also supports TypeScript 3.5, which recently came out, and Smart Selection for TypeScript and JavaScript. And even cooler, I love this, the integrated terminal now has true 24-bit color support. So huzzah, yay. And there are tons of other updates and improvements too. I've got a link to the blog post and download links down below so you can check all that out. And side note, I've been using a new theme called SynthWave 84. I'm going to link to it down below, but it's so cool. It's got a completely like retro 80s vibe. It's really, really awesome. Speaking of terminals, the Windows terminal was easily one of my favorite announcements from Microsoft Build. And the terminal will be released later this year, but it's open source and it's on GitHub right now, which is awesome because that means that you can, contribute if you want to. And so Rich Turner has actually authored a contributor's guide on GitHub outlining the various contribution process. And so if you want to offer a suggestion or report a bug or add a feature, be sure to check that guide out. And I've linked to it down below. And Rich does just a great job kind of overlaying how to get the most out of the experience. I also want to highlight a blog post from last week that details how WSL, or the Windows Subsystem for Linux, allows Windows to access Linux files. And this was a big new feature that was added as part of the latest Windows 10 release, and it's something that I know a lot of us have really longed for. I know for me it was something I really was excited about. And so there's a video that goes into the details too. And although this video and this talk was kind of done actually before WSL2 was announced, Craig says that there are very few changes to how this will work under the new architecture. Basically, the biggest change with WSL2 will be where Linux files themselves are stored, but the hows is basically the same. And so links to that blog post and video are down below. And speaking of video, we've got lots of great content this week on Channel 9 and across our various dev properties. So first up, over on FiveThings, Burke learns about 5 tools for building APIs with GraphQL from Chris. And over on Visual Studio Toolbox, we've got an episode on IntelliSense and how you can cut down how much code you need to type. And like, who doesn't love that? And over on Career Behind the Code, David Fowler shares his story about how he moved from being a dev to being an architect. And it's a really, really interesting conversation, so be sure to check that out. And on the IoT show, Olivier talks about securing IoT with Eustace Ashinangwa, and that's a great conversation too. If you wanted to try .NET but you haven't known where to start, I want to point you to a new tool that we've got called Try.NET. And Try.NET is a way to create interactive .NET documentation using .NET Core all within a web browser. So it's a really easy way of kind of getting started, and it's visual to boot. And Jim Bennett, who's an amazing person who has literally sent me weird stuffed animals because he knows that I love them, he's got a great overview about how it works over on his blog, and I've linked to his blog post as well as the Try.NET project so that you can get started. Speaking of cool browser tools, my dear friend and former colleague, Sarah Drasner, has created an amazing CSS grid generator for anybody who wants to get started with CSS grid. And it is such a cool project, so thank you so much for making it, Sarah. And it's also on GitHub if anybody wants to make changes or fork it. And now it's time for my pick of the week. Okay, so I have to give it to our friends down south. And by that, I mean the people in Australia and New Zealand, because they, frankly, really know how to have more fun. And so amazingly, Xbox ANZ has partnered with Lynx, and that's known as Axe Body Spray in the US, to create, and I am not joking, Xbox Body Wash. And I don't even know what to say here. It's ridiculous and outrageous, and you know what? I kind of love it. So if you're in Australia or New Zealand, please, 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 please send this to me. I will pay full shipping because I need this for the kitsch value alone. All right, that does it for me. Let me know your thoughts on Xbox-branded bath products and everything else we talked about in the comments. And while you're there, go ahead and give this video a like and go ahead and subscribe to Microsoft Developer for all of your dev news and content. See you next time.